And you can go ahead, Professor Mann.
Okay, so we're going to focus on the 1960s, but I wanted to start by just flagging two important musical events prior to the 1960s that are really formative in the use of music as in protest during the civil rights movement. And these both happened in April of 1939. The first one is Marian Anderson's Easter concert at the Lincoln Memorial. And Marian Anderson was a very celebrated classically trained singer singing European canon opera music, but also Negro spirituals. And she was very popular. There was a desire to have her perform in Washington, D.C. at the DAR, the Daughters of the American Revolution Constitution Hall, which was the largest venue in the city. And that was a segregated venue. They did not allow Black performers. And so as sort of a way of protesting that and to make it possible for as many people to see her as possible, various people, including the then First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, organized a concert at the Lincoln Memorial, an Easter concert where Marian Anderson sang. Thousands and thousands of people came. And it's the same location, as you can see from this photo, of the March on Washington. And so this was a concert that really marked a push against segregation, a push for integration. And then, you know, a few decades later in 1963, we had the March on Washington. Martin Luther King Jr. stood roughly in the same space and made the made his I Have a Dream speech. The other pre-1960s musical intervention by an African-American woman that I want to draw your attention to is Billie Holiday's song, Strange Fruit. And it's a song that she began singing at a place called the Cafe Society in Manhattan. It was kind of a hip downtown club. Progressive people went there. It was an integrated space. And Strange Fruit was an anti-lynching anthem. And she released this song as a single record in April of 1939. And it was the first time that you had an African-American singer making a very direct protest record. And she sort of sets the stage for the protest music that follows in the 1950s and 1960s and moving forward. So what I'm going to do today is talk about I want to give you three examples of women's voices in the 1960s in the protest social commentary mode, and then we'll conclude with a kind of gesture to what's happening more like right now. And I want to start with some recognition of how important music was to the actual process of protesting. And so just to get some sound in our ears, this is from a recording, and I'll show you the cover of the recording in a moment, but this is from a recording that collected the music that the activists, the civil rights activists who were working primarily in the South, were using to accompany their protests. And not just going out in the streets and protesting, but also at their meetings, when they were organizing, when they were planning, they would always start with a prayer, and then they would follow with a song, maybe several songs, to get their energy going. So I just want to give you an example of that sound.
Yeah.
So you hear them. Now, you can tell those are not professional singers. Those are activists, mostly in the teenage years and in their 20s. And you can hear in these opening songs, this was something that they just started out on this particular, at this particular meeting to get themselves energized. You can hear them repeating the word freedom. And freedom is really the operative word. This is what the activists were fighting for. So when we talk about this period and this activism, we talk about the civil rights movement, and it's true that they were seeking rights, they were seeking legal rights, they were seeking changes in laws. But when they talked about what they were hoping for, the word that they used was freedom. And when Celeste invited me, she said she was inspired by the Nina Simone song, "I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free." And it's free, not how it would feel to have rights. So it's this idea, this desire for freedom that's motivating the activists. So I just wanted to give a little bit of background before I talk more about the specific music and the recordings that I asked you all to listen to if you had a chance. I want us to listen to a little bit from this, the sort of on the ground music that the activists were singing to keep themselves motivated. I'll then talk about a song by Nina Simone and then a song by the Staple Singer. So those will be the three songs that we look at. So all of this music is happening against the backdrop of the civil rights movement and activism in the 1960s. And it's actually also helping to propel that movement. It's very, very important to understand that music is integrated and it's integral to the movement. It's not just soundtrack. It's deeply connected with the process and practice of activism. So some of the things people were doing starting in 1960, you had lunch counter sit-ins, and this is really action towards desegregation. So lunch counter sit-ins, freedom rides, of course, the March on Washington, and then the famous Selma to Montgomery March, which is known as Bloody Sunday. And this is all nonviolent direct action, recognizing that, especially in the South, African Americans didn't have voting rights. And so they had to use other means to draw attention to their issues and to make social change. And so being out in the streets, whether that was through sit-ins, marches, demonstrations, whether it was boycotting stores that wouldn't hire African Americans, or in some department stores, they wouldn't let African Americans try on clothing or shoes. You just had to guess what, you know, was going to work for you, or mass demonstrations. All of this was nonviolent and it was direct action. So this is a different mode of politics than had been seen in the United States. And as I said, it was really propelled by young people who wanted to make social change. So with the civil rights movement, and I'm gonna focus on Dr. Bernice Johnson Reagan, who was one of the original members of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee singing group. And she was the person who put together this album. So this is the album that first set of songs came from, and the next couple that we'll listen to is from them, this album as well. For Bernice Johnson Reagan, the role of music, she talks about the role of music a great deal. And as we think about what they're doing, we can think about the shift in focus from music as music for worship, which is very, very integral in African-American communities, in Protestant communities in the South. Music played is absolutely essential to worship. They build on that in their use of music in the civil rights movement, and they adapt the lyrics of familiar songs from church services to the political context. This is not music as entertainment. It's music as a tool for activism. And so everyone is expected to sing and participate. It's not about whether you have a good voice. It's lending your voice to the movement. Now, the SNCC Freedom Singers, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, Freedom Singers were a group that formed in 1961. And we have the picture of the four of the founding members here. And these were people who were good singers. And they were activists whose role was to bring the message of the movement through song around the country. They were fundraising when they did this, and it was a way to get more and more people involved with the movement and let people know what was going on in the movement. So I have two songs, and I'll play just a little bit of both of them. Ruth Mae Harris is one of the founding members, and this is the song, We Shall Not Be Moved. Of course, the most famous of all of the civil rights songs, era songs, is We Shall Overcome. And that is an adaptation of an African-American hymn called I Shall Overcome Someday. The activists over time adapted it to We Shall Overcome Someday. And so sort of another version of that idea is We Shall Not Be Moved. And so these freedom singers, the SNCC freedom singers, and SNCC was the student movement, student organization that was working alongside Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s organization, the SCLC, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. These were song leaders, and they would, in a moment out on the protest at the organizing meeting, would raise the song, and then others would join in. And so they're tapping into the tradition in African-American churches where everybody participated in singing. So here we'll listen to about a minute of Ruth Mae Harris singing, We Shall Not Be Moved.
We shall not be moved. We shall not be moved. We shall not, my love, we shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's a planet by the waters. Oh, we shall not be moved. We shall not.
Okay, so I'll stop that and then just go to my next example, which is, this is Bernice Johnson Reagan leading the song, Woke Up This Morning With My Mind on Freedom. And in this song, they took a traditional religious song with my mind stayed on Jesus, or my mind focused on Jesus, and it's freedom that they're focused on. And these were songs, for example, the previous song, you can imagine singing that song if you're being arrested and you are being moved, but you're singing that song back at the police officers who are arresting you to indicate, no, but we're still gonna keep fighting. So these songs had, you know, had a lot of powerful meanings associated with them as they were used. So just a little bit of Bernice Johnson Reagan with Woke Up This Morning.
I woke up this morning when the man said I'm freedom. Oh, and I woke up this morning when the man said I'm freedom. Oh, and I woke up this morning when the man.
So just, again, a couple of quick examples. And you notice with these songs that they're fairly simple songs, not a lot of lyrics to remember, very easy to join in. If we were all together, maybe we would try joining in and singing along with them. And this is important for organizing and keeping people together as a group when you're out marching, or these are also songs that they would sing when they were in jail. And it was just a way to keep their voices lifted. So it's not about complicated lyrics and ideas. It's a pretty focused idea and lyrics that everyone can remember and share. So Bernice Johnson Reagan, after doing a lot of work with SNCC, In the 60s and the 1970s, she went to Howard University and got a doctorate in history. And her focus was the African-American spiritual music tradition. And she's thought a lot about the role of music in African-American culture. And she talks about freedom songs and this music she refers to as freedom songs as an instrument for the articulation of community concerns and as a way to enable the community to become visible. If you can imagine the invisibility and the marginality that African Americans felt in a lot of Southern communities, raising their voices in song and taking up sonic space was really important. It was part of the politics. It was part of the disruption and the drawing of attention to their concerns. And so she says, our image of ourselves was enlarged when the sounds of the freedom songs filled all the space in that church, referring to the churches where they would meet and plan their activist projects. She also talks about the way sound is a way to extend the territory you can affect. You can take up a lot of space, a lot more space sonically than you can physically. And people would hear them, you know, coming before they actually saw them if they were on a march. And so the sound again is very important to marking out territory and expressing their concerns. And the final quote that I have of hers here maybe sounds a little circuitous. She says, songs were a way to get to singing. And what she means by that is that when you sing, and especially when you're singing together as a group, it's a way of forging a sense of connection with each other as your voices are connecting to each other. You're also feeling a stronger sense of a bond. And also just as an individual singing, when you sing, things change in your body and your mind and your feeling, and the words that you're saying can help that move, that change happen. And so the music was really important to the consciousness, shaping the consciousness of the activists who were doing very risky things back in the 1960s, protesting against segregation and trying to get, you know, real rights and freedom for African Americans. So with those examples, that's much more kind of on the ground music for protest. I want to shift and talk about Nina Simone, who is a professional singer. She was a pianist. She was classically trained. And then she ended up through various paths becoming someone kind of hard to put in a genre, but sort of jazz, sort of folk, sort of soul. And she was a very popular singer in the late 1950s, early 1960s. And then as the civil rights movement starts to take hold, she gets more and more caught up in it, talking with her friends, excuse me, about what's going on. And then a series of things happened in 1963, excuse me. The first thing is in June, the civil rights activist, NAACP field secretary, Medgar Evers, is shot dead in front of his home in Mississippi. And this was very distressing to many of, you know, to everyone in the civil rights movement, because again, nonviolent, peaceful protests, but then you can be killed by Southern white racists who don't think that African Americans should have the right to vote. So that was the first thing that happened, 1963 in the summer. And then at the end of the summer, of course, very famously, the March on Washington, where Martin Luther King Jr. delivers the I Have a Dream speech in the same space where Marian Anderson had her concert back in 1939. And everyone's spirits were very high, very lifted, because that was such a successful event. And it was peaceful. There was no violence. There was a lot of concern that there would be violence. It was very peaceful. And then just a few weeks later in September of 1963, the 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama was bombed. And four young girls who were there for Sunday school were killed in the bombing. And then a fifth girl was blinded. And so this was a devastating thing. And again, violence in the face of this nonviolent protest for African American rights. So Nina Simone's response to this was to write a song. And the song she wrote is called Mississippi Goddamn. And this is a song written in 1963. We're in a much more permissive time. In 1963, you were not supposed to curse, take the Lord's name in vain, and certainly not make it the title of a song. But this is what Nina Simone did as a way to express what she was feeling and what she was thinking in the wake of all of these events, the events that I just mentioned, and also other events and other responses to civil rights activism. So I'm gonna play the song, Mississippi Goddamn, and as you listen to the song, I'm gonna play the whole song. I can't figure out how to stop the song. It has a sort of energy of its own. So I'm gonna play the whole song. And as I play it, I'm asking you to listen, to think about what she's expressing through the lyrics, through the musical arrangement, and through the way she delivers her vocal delivery of the lyrics. Now to do this, I want to show you the lyrics so that you're sure to, you know, catch them all. So I have to do a little bit of a switch here. I'm gonna start the song and it's gonna take me a moment to get back to the power. Bear with me.
The name of this tune is Mississippi Goddamn. And I mean every word of it. Alabama's gotten me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest. And everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn. Alabama's gotten me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest, and everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn. Can't you see it? Can't you feel it? It's all in the air. I can't stand the pressure much longer. Somebody say a prayer. Alabama's gotten me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest, and everybody knows. Show tune, but the show hasn't been written for it yet. Hound dogs on my trail, school children sitting in jail, black cat cross my path. I think every day's gonna be my last. Lord have mercy on this land of mine. We all gonna get it in due time. I don't belong here, I don't belong there. I've even stopped believing in prayer. Don't tell me, I'll tell you. Me and my people just about do. I've been there, so I know. Keep on saying, go slow. But that's just the trouble. Slow. Washing the windows. Slow. Picking the cotton. Slow. You're just plain rotten. Slow. You're too damn lazy. Slow. You thought I was kidding, dude. Picket lines, school boycotts, they try to say it's a communist plot. All I want is equality for my sister, my brother, my people, and me. Yes, you lied to me all these years. You told me to wash and clean my ears and talk real fine, just like a lady. And you'd stop calling me Sister Sadie. trouble. Desegregation, mass participation, unification. Do things gradually, but bring more tragedy. Why don't you see it? Why don't you feel it? I don't know, I don't know. You don't have to live next to me, just give me my equality.
So I'll go back to sharing the screen. Does anyone want to make any comments on the song or ask any questions? I'll go to my next, my blank slide. Celeste, is there a question?
There is a question I have.
Okay.
In the lyrics, the Sister Sadie that she's referring to, who is that that she was referring to?
I think what she's doing with that reference is, I think she's making reference to the fact that in a lot of Southern communities, there was a refusal of white Southerners to address Black Americans, adults, as Mr. or Mrs. or Miss. They would call them things like Aunt Sarah, or, you know, brother so-and-so, or uncle so-and-so, or sister Sadie, as a refusal of the respect that the title Mr., Mrs., or Miss would afford them. So I think that's what she's saying there. I don't know that there's an actual character or figure named Sister Sadie that she had in mind. And maybe she needed that for the line to scan.
Was the song well received in the Black community, with the exception of Goddamn and the title and the lyrics, or was it kind of universally disregarded because of not only the content but also the profanity, which we wouldn't call that now?
Yeah, I think that it was in the activist community, people were very, very fond of Nina Simone when she, you know, once she put this song out, you know, it really, she had already been supportive of civil rights activism, doing concerts and donating the proceeds from the concerts to various civil rights organizations. But this song really solidified her status among the activists. For the mainstream of the African-American community, you know, the opinions would vary based on, you know, what people thought, whether people thought it was appropriate to make these kinds of statements in public. And that's really what I wanted you all to think about, in terms of what, you know, what is she saying in the song and how is she saying it? It's a very unusual kind of expression for an African-American woman to make in 1963. And I'm thinking about the ways that this song crosses the line. There was a certain kind of behavior that African Americans were trying to assume as they were doing this activism. There's a lot of politics of respectability, trying to comport themselves in ways that show that they are just as, you know, capable of being good citizens as white people. And so if you, you know, a lot of times you see civil rights activists, they're dressed, the men are wearing, you know, suits, the women are look like they're wearing their Sunday best, you know, gloves and hats and everything, trying to show how respectable they are. And Nina Simone basically throws that out the window, starting with the title, you know, starting with this curse, like she's cursing the state of Mississippi, or she's just shaking her head saying, you know, God damn, what is going on with that place? Why are they treating us this way? And she's angry. She was so upset and so angry especially when those girls were killed, you know, innocent children, as she thought about it. And she decides she's going to express that rage in her music. She wrote the song herself. A lot of the songs that she sang up to that point were songs composed by other people. This song she wrote herself to express her rage and impatience. she's also starting to sort of stray away from that discourse of nonviolence that Dr. King is associated with, and also against the discourse of integration. There's a point where she says, you know, you don't have to live next to me. I'm not looking for integration. I just want my freedom. I just want my rights. She's not fully, she respected Dr. King a great deal, but she's not fully on board with the turning of the other cheek and the trying to love one's enemy. She's over, you know, the enemies. She also makes very direct and contentious attacks on whites. She says, I don't trust you anymore. She talks about how you lied. And at that time, calling someone a liar, that the word lie was a kind of inflammatory word. We've lost that sense of it now. But to say you've lied to me and I don't trust you, those were very kind of in your face statements to make. Very, again, very unapologetic. She's refusing this line of going slow. This is also something that Martin Luther King was very frustrated with all of the ministers, Southern ministers saying, I think you all are going too fast with this desegregation. So she's also critical of that going slow. And then again, as I said, obviously taking the Lord's name in vain to talk about the social situation, and especially for a woman to curse in such a public way. So this song really, you know, as I said, solidifies her for the civil rights activists. And she does other songs that have political content, political messages, and remains closely associated with the civil rights movement up until the point when Dr. King is assassinated. And then at that point, things sort of, it's a little difficult for everyone, you know, knowing how to proceed after that. But one of the songs she writes is in memory of and in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. After he had passed. So, you know, in taking on this kind of new focus on the politics, she's doing something that most pop musicians did not do. There were many musicians who were support and actors and other artists who were supportive of the civil rights movement, but most of them were not writing songs about the issues. They would sing their usual repertoire and then make donations to various civil rights organizations. But she was actually writing songs that pertained to the things that the activists were thinking about and dealing with. So it really set her apart. And her response to people questioning her about doing this was to say, you know, how can you be an artist and not reflect the times? This is what's going on in the world around me. So I'm an artist, I'm going to comment on these things. And she had, she wasn't the only one, she was one of a few. She wasn't the only one doing this. And I want to end by talking about another group, the Staple Singers, who also made that turn to politics. This is an old picture, an early picture of them. The group formed, it's a family group formed in 1948. The father and three of his kids, the youngest daughter, Mavis, the youngest kid at the time was Mavis. She was 9 years old when the group started. And she was actually, even at that age, one of the two lead singers. She and Pops would share the leads. And they were singing gospel music. So this was an opportunity for the Staple family, who were living in Chicago, to join in a very vibrant gospel music scene that was happening in Chicago. Pops was from Mississippi. He grew up on the Dockery Plantation, or near the Dockery Plantation, which is where a lot of the classic blues men grew up. So he grew up listening to the blues. You see him with his guitar. And so their sound is a kind of blues-based, kind of country gospel sound, a little bit different from more piano-based gospel music. And very early on, Mavis emerged as kind of a star, or maybe the star of the group, because she was so young and because she had what they all called a heavy voice, a low voice. She could even sing lower than her father and her brother. So the Staple Singers are on the gospel circuit. They get, you know, pretty well known on that circuit for their country sound. And then in the 1960s, they start to cross paths with the civil rights activists. And they actually go to a meeting at Dr. King's church, and things start to change for them. So Mavis Staples, reflecting on this, recalled, quote, "We made the transition to protest songs when we heard Dr. King and we visited his church. Pops called us into his room and said, 'If this man can preach this, we can sing it and put a beat under it,'" end quote. So they start to try to integrate the ideas of the freedom movement into the songs that they're performing. And so that really starts in the 1960s. And they see themselves as, you know, working with Dr. Martin Luther King. They do fundraising. They were actually supposed to be doing an event with Martin Luther King Jr. in early April of 1968 at the at the sanitation worker strike in Memphis, but he was assassinated. But they were supposed to arrive, I think, the next day to be on the platform with him at an event. So they did work with him, and they began to integrate political messages into their songs. Pops started to write music going beyond, you know, singing the traditional gospel repertoire. So for example, he wrote, "Why Am I Treated So Bad?" in honor of the Little Rock Nine, the Black high school students that segregationists physically prevented from entering and integrating a white high school in Arkansas. That had happened back in 1957. He reflected on that and wrote this song. He commemorated the 1963 March on Washington in the song "Long Walk to DC." And then in 1965, he wrote a song called "Freedom Highway," and it was in response to the devastating attack on protesters trying to march across the Edmund Pettus Bridge and Selma in that Selma to Montgomery march. And they recorded the song very soon after he wrote the song, and he wrote the song very soon after these events occurred. So this, the version of "Freedom Highway" that I'm going to play is live, recorded at one of the churches that they regularly performed at in Chicago, the New Nazareth Baptist Church. What I have on this slide is his intro, and this is what he says. This is his spoken word intro. So I just want you to take a look at it, and then I will play the song. I wasn't able to get both of them on the same slide. And so part of my technical limitations. So he's just describing how he came to write the song. And then you'll hear the group sing the song.
A few days ago, the Freedom Marchers marched from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama. I know some of you know about that. That was in March 1965. And from that march, word was revealed, and a song was composed. And we wrote a song about the freedom marches, and we call it the Freedom Highway. And we dedicate this number to all of the freedom marches. And it goes something like this. Thank you. say amen again. Keep on marching. Everybody talking about him is not doing that. I want to make heaven my home, but I want to enjoy myself a little down here too. I wonder, can I get a witness tonight? Keep on marching. A freedom's highway.
So you hear at the end, Pop Staples making that connection between heaven and wanting some kind of heaven on earth. And it's consistent with what the Staples Singers did throughout their career post 1962 or so, when they started this shift. They stayed true to the liberatory side of African-American sacred music and redemption, ideas of redemption, but they expanded the content to talk about contemporary issues. And while they're drawing on gospel's emphasis on heavenly freedom and redemption, they reposition it to speak about the quest for earthly freedom. And this was, you know, these are among the ideas that are galvanizing civil rights activists. So they keep to that message. Often it's a very inspirational message. Sometimes it's a more political message. And that is something that was consistent with the group throughout the career of the group. And then after Pops passed away in the early 2000s and Mavis Staples went on her own, she continued that to give that message. I don't have time to play the song Build a Bridge, but she continued that kind of inspirational message and that kind of linking of gospel, the sort of gospel feel and gospel ideas, but also politics, on the ground politics in her music, working with Jeff Tweedy from the alt-rock group Wilco in the early 2000s, actually from around 2011 on, and actually kind of revitalized and had a solo career, revitalized her career and had a solo career, won some Grammys, with these, again, kind of inspirational messages with social and political content. And as she's doing this in the beginning, early years of the 21st century, she's, sort of the old guard. She's in her 70s when she makes this shift and starts working with Tweedy. But she's actually, she's definitely not alone. And so I just want to conclude by mentioning some of the other African-American women who are sounding revolution in their music, to use again the idea that that Celeste gave me to organize the paper around. And so just some quick examples: Janelle Monáe with Wonderland here in this photo, Hell You Talking About, which is basically a litany of the names of African-Americans who have been killed by police or other sort of self-appointed arbiters of justice. And they simply sing the names of these people as a way of expressing outrage at their unjust killings. You have Lauryn Hill, kind of in the tradition of Nina Simone, expressing her rage. And she uses the very sweet kind of almost saccharine song, My Favorite Things, from the musical, The Sound of Music. And if you're familiar with that song, you can kind of hum it and figure out the lines of the, or how the song falls, talking about her rage against the way, or rage about the ways African-Americans are treated. Black Human Packages, Tied Up in Strings, making a reference to lynching that Billie Holiday refers to in the song Strange Fruit, just as another example. You have Solange in a song For Us, By Us, or FUBU, kind of referring to a line of clothing, African-American designed clothing from the 80s or 90s, but applying it to a conversation about microaggressions and the kinds of everyday racism that, and often unwitting racism, that African-Americans are subjected to. You have her very recently, just this past year, in response to the murder of George Floyd, write the song, I Can't Breathe. And then I'll just conclude with, because she actually uses the word freedom in the title, Beyoncé's song from Lemonade, titled Freedom, you know, again, tapping into this this idea that has that galvanized African-American activists and protests throughout throughout US history, and laying claim to that term and talking about wanting to, you know, do whatever she has to do to attain her freedom. So you hear in these songs by these women, they're also, I'm focused on women for this talk, but you also have examples, obviously, people like Kendrick Lamar and Jay-Z and Childish Gambino, who are also continuing this tradition of critique, social commentary, protest, inspiration, using their music in different ways to speak to their communities and beyond their communities about the issues that concern African Americans. So I'll end there, and I'm happy to take your questions or comments.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Mann. I do want to let the group that's here know, and on the chat know, that we can take questions. And I did get a comment or two in the chat to share. But while people are formulating their thoughts, again, thank you for your presentation. I know that some people who may watch this on playback, or you know, we have with us in the room our 2B, you know, intern class, mm-hmm. Who are starting in a week, next week, as OBGYN residents, and have lots of trainees who participate in these lectures. And thus far, over the past 11 months up to now, we've had some obvious link to medicine or healthcare, in each of our presentations. And so, because I have a platform, I do want to comment that, although it may seem, you know, that this lecture is unrelated to what we do on a day-to-day basis as physicians, I think it was really important to me, not only because I love music and because this is my history as an African American, but because I think it's important for us as physicians to recognize the humanity and the patients that we are taking care of, and see them as whole people, and through art and music or visual arts, what have you, that is a way to understand people and how they express themselves and what they care about, and where they come from. And so to all the trainees who may watch this, and those who are here today, you know, making sure to stress and understand that knowing this history is not important because, not just important because you're an American and this is our history, and, you know, but it will help us to see our patients as whole people, especially that we take care of mostly women patients. That's why, mm-hmm. I wanted to focus the talk on Black women, knowing how, you know, risky it is for Black women in obstetrics and gynecology today. So with that comment, I will open up the floor for more questions. And if you, Professor Mann, have comments on that, as a Black woman and someone who hopefully one day will see an OBGYN for your well-being and for your health. But you know, what would it mean to you to know that your physician were familiar with this information, and why do you think it's important? Is how I'll just open the floor for questions in addition to what I just said.
Okay. Well, I wouldn't limit it to physicians. I really think this is important information for everyone to have. And I especially think this because African American music is so popular. I don't want to make any assumptions about the people who are viewing this, but I think it's almost inescapable. So if you're someone who listens to music, there's pretty good chance that some of the music that you're listening to is coming out of the African-American tradition. If it's not performed by an African-American person, it may still be coming out of that tradition, because in music, African-Americans have been so influential and formative in the United States. So I think on the one hand, we are very familiar with the music, but we don't know so much about the history of the people who have created that music. And so what I presented today comes from a course that I teach, a semester long course that I call Freedom Songs, that talks about African-American history, and specifically the history of protest and the battle for civil rights, and then what went on in the post-civil rights era, alongside the history of the development of different African-American musical styles. Those are just two things that I'm very interested in. And I think it's actually important to have some of that information. And it does go to what you were saying, Celeste, about the humanity of the people, because I think it's possible to listen to the music and to enjoy the music and not really think about the people who have created it or the communities out of which this music comes. And I think it's actually important to have that context. And so I think it's a great idea, to just know about, you all are dealing with people from many different communities. I mean, this is the sort of United States of the 21st century. We've always been a multicultural nation, and it's even more intensely so. And so I think it's probably helpful for you all as you're, working with your patients to have some knowledge about their cultures and the different, the different cultures that they're coming from. I'm a cultural anthropologist, so that's my bias, is to think that culture is important, that it matters. And so I think just having the opportunity to learn something about African-American culture, maybe, in another event, you'll learn about South Asian culture. At another event, you'll learn about different Latino cultures. So I think having that information can only be helpful. And again, sorry about all my crazy ambient sound.
That's okay. It looks like Madison has a question.
Yeah. Good afternoon. Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
All right, perfect. This has been so informative, and I really appreciate the information, because I'm an elementary school teacher, and in teaching Black history as American history, not very often do we focus on music and the impact that has had on Black history as well. And so this has been very insightful for me. And as someone who wants to learn more about the influence of music, I wanted to ask, what are some of maybe your top one or two artists or songs that have had the most influence on you and have resonated with you thus far?
Wow, that's such a hard question because there's so many. I'll tell you two artists. One is Nina Simone, who I talked about today. I've listened to Nina Simone since I was about 5 years old. I've just been a fan of hers. And once I started teaching, I learned much more about her. And I just think her music across her career is really interesting and inspiring. And it's not that every song is perfect, but just the things that she's attempting to do, I think are really fascinating. And then another artist who I really like, and I used one of his songs in my class, is Jimi Hendrix. And I use his version of the Star Spangled Banner that he performed at Woodstock, the Woodstock concert of 1969. And it's a kind of deconstruction of the national anthem, and a kind of a critique or commentary on the politics and on the violence of the United States. So, and I just think he's also a phenomenal guitarist, and I like other songs by him. So those are two, but that's a really hard question, because there really are so many phenomenal artists.
Thank you for sharing.
Mm-hmm. We have another question from the audience. Do you want me to bring a mic to you? You want me to ask it?
Yeah, do you mind asking it? How these songs of protest were distributed back in the 60s? Like, were companies picking these up and producing them, or were they more like live shows and that's how people heard them?
Mm-hmm. So the Nina Simone song that I played for you came from an album from a live performance at Carnegie Hall. And so it circulated like her other albums did. And it's one song among many songs. I think there's one other political song on that album called Go Limp, which is a kind of double entendre song. And the rest of the songs are more, you know, traditional kind of love songs and romance songs. There might be another sort of political song in there too. She does a Kurt Vile song. But Nina Simone was signed to Philips, I think was the record label. So she was signed to a mainstream record label, and the music circulated that way. The Staple Singers were also on an independent record label. So they were producing record albums that circulated. They never had really widespread circulation in the 1960s, but in the early 1970s, they were on the Stax record label, which was the soul record label. And they were doing more inspirational style, less directly political style stuff. Songs like Respect Yourself and I'll Take You There. And those were huge. Those were on the Billboard charts. So in the 1960s, you have a lot of the artists, African-American artists, are on independent labels because major labels weren't always ready to sign African-American artists. And those independent labels did circulate the music. So a group like The Impressions, Curtis Mayfield's group, they had a lot of songs with political messages. And the interesting thing is that sometimes, so there were records circulating and then people would listen to the radio. Radio was really important for hearing music, especially in Black communities. People would have the radio on all day. Some of the Black radio stations were not comfortable playing these songs. They felt that they were too inflammatory. And so, you know, we might assume, oh, it would be, you know, white radio stations, they wouldn't play this music, and the Black radio stations would. In many cases, the Black radio stations were also, they were very cautious. And so there was a song by The Impressions called We're a Winner, which is really just a positive message song about sort of like Black pride, kind of like the James Brown song I'm Black and I'm Proud. And there are a lot of Black radio stations that didn't play that song. So radio was one way when you could get the song on the air. And then records were very important. And then yes, when these artists would tour, they would play these songs live.
Professor Mann, thank you very, very much for your time this afternoon. I'll send you the link to the recording when it's up on our YouTube page. And thank you again so much for sharing this with us.
Great, thank you all.
Have a great afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you for your time and your attention.
Bye.